So, you know, it was interesting because during lockdown, there was it was fascinating because a lot of the Muslim, Muslim circles just within Sydney hopped onto Clubhouse, and a lot of interesting discussions happened along the way. But if I recall, during that time as well, you also released like the article, right, with ABC, or you did the article called it's titled "As the Eldest Daughter in My Family, I Know All Too Well the Weight of Responsibility," essentially where it talked about Muslim struggles in the context of COVID. Because as I mentioned, like, I guess during lockdown, and Sydney was crazy because essentially I was like beating my chest to friends that I've overseas saying, oh yeah, Sydney and Australia is doing great during COVID because like it's not as intense and lockdown isn't intense. The rest of the world seems a bit messed up. And out of the blue, the Delta variant happened and everything went into lockdown, and it was pretty like heavy lockdown as well, to the point where it was like army on the streets and stuff like that. So I guess in that sense, there was a lot of struggles, obviously, right? And I guess the Muslim community has specific struggles in of itself during those times. But in terms of, you know, you doing that article and what was the experience doing that, and what were the unique viewpoints you uncovered that you may not have been aware of beforehand when it comes to ways as Muslims were doing it tough during COVID, and, you know, specifically, I guess, in the Sydney context as well?
Yeah, to be honest, that article was not about canvassing Muslim experiences at all, because it's really, it was just speaking to a wider audience of people who are daughters who are firstborn from an immigrant background that may necessarily not be Muslim at all. Given the reaction to the piece, which is one of the things that was most unexpected, I seem to have touched a nerve based on the feedback that I got, as being one of the most like popular pieces for ABC every day at the time. And I guess it's just one of those things where I wonder whether if I was a man, whether I would be pigeonholed the same way if I was not so visible, if I changed my name to, I don't know, Raheem or something, and I was a guy, would I be asked if I did a piece like that, was this canvassing the Muslim experience? But I don't think I would have gotten that question at all. And from reading the piece, I think one of my talents were Muslim, but it wasn't completely obvious that it was. It was really more so about this general experience that I was trying to put into words. And to be honest, it was something that I had been thinking about for a while. And it was a follow-up to a story that I did in July. I really worked on it through June, but in July, about eldest daughters like uncovering like a specific like mental health struggle. And this was the kind of thing that spanned borders, and I did it as a radio package, first of all. And one of my talents were an entire podcast based in the UK that is just dedicated to getting eldest daughters in therapy. And the thing that struck me then, and the thing that struck me now while doing this story, is that there is a little to no research in psychology around this phenomena, but it's gaining traction, that they're now trying to label it and identify it. And it was so interesting to speak to like a psychologist and counselor about this, because the symptoms or like the signposts that she saw in all of these women that spanned across generation and age and background and faith, it was like it was that weird phenomenon of being like, how were we all raised the same? How do we all come out functioning with, well, how do we come out functioning at all, really? But how did we all end up with like such similar tics and problems and views on life and specific struggles? Like it was too uncanny to not be a coincidence, you know? So I did what any journalist would have done, and was just trying to dig into it to find the answers about it. And subhanAllah, at the end, I think of the radio package, I found out that in the UK there were a couple of grants granted to PhD students to actually start looking into this as a legitimate thing. But then when it came to the piece, while in lockdown, it was really just taking what I had learnt then and adapting it to the Sydney lockdown situation. And even though it was based in Sydney, the reactions were obviously not from everyone in Sydney. It touched people in Melbourne who were also in lockdown. It went international as well. I was very surprised by that, but it was clear that I had touched a nerve, because one of the more interesting things about lockdown, I feel, is not just all the policy decisions, the outcomes and the impacts that they had on us in Sydney, or specifically in Western Sydney, but it was about what lockdowns uncovered within our households personally that we had to deal with, where, you didn't have an outside life to keep you busy, to distract you from real issues and problems that have just been sitting there right in front of you, and you have no room. You can't run away from it. You have to address it head on. And I think that's where a lot of the engagement with it came from. But all in all, I think no matter what I do, being very visible, I think we collectively in Australia have a long way to go before we are able to say that, like, whatever kind of journalism I or any other hijabi will do will just be seen as journalism and not just like journalism with an asterisk and in brackets saying this will apply to Muslims because of the symbolism.
Yeah, mashallah, there's a lot to touch on there. And I think what comes to mind straight away in regards to your last point is that I assume especially in a lockdown situation, especially for different people, different personalities, essentially, because as you alluded to or mentioned specifically about everyone, being in the household, and hence as a result, you have to tackle, things or issues head on. And naturally, some people, because of, people having to go out and do stuff or work and all that, people may have moments where they are to themselves and they have that time to themselves, and it's really important for each people from a mental health perspective to have that, space, etc. So always having that intensity, always having that, amount of people at home and etc. can take a toll. And I assume it kind of intertwines as well with your earlier point about, especially, for example, the phenomena of like eldest daughters, in the family or even within the Muslim context and the specific struggles they go through. And I guess within lockdown, like that exacerbates, sort of the issues that women within households or even eldest daughters may in a specific context or even daughters in general like would have to go through. And so I want to also ask, on top of that, have you found that, because you said it gained attention worldwide, was that really, because at the end of the day, like Muslim issues, it's not just like sorry, Muslim women's issues, like women's issues, I guess, you have different communities and different faith groups other aside from, Muslims specifically, would also look at the article and relate in some way, shape or form as well, because there's that sort of relatability. And within the context of, going, worldwide, was it more so that, you know, other women from other, you know, faiths or other communities were also relating to aspects of, you know, parts that you articulated within the article? Or would you say it's a very specific Muslim women issues that you are not saying that that's specifically what you're getting at, but would you say in general, the wider kind of women community of women in different groups and faith groups are also, you know, very much relating to what you were touching on as well?
Yeah, you could say that the majority were women. And I think the funny thing with engagement and reaction to things that you do is that, you know, you can't really anticipate how big or how fast things would be growing, or what things or what issues would be more pertinent for people to react to and relate to. But it was mostly women locally, and if it went internationally, it was because they had that immigrant background. And I think what happened is the 6 degrees of separation thing kind of happens, where you've got enough mutuals for it to gain traction and basically leave the bubble that you're in for sure. But that didn't mean that I didn't get like responses from men at all. Or when it came to like quote unquote say non-Muslims who don't have that proximity or don't know anyone personally, or don't come from the similar family structures as we do, it helped contextualize and add another point to the struggle of what it was happening in Western Sydney during that time of lockdown. Because one of the biggest issues I starkly remember at the time is that there was a frustration towards the latter half of Sydney as to their mobility and why the Delta strain kept spreading amongst families, and why there was this constant movement going on. And I think the article helped address and contextualize, being like, it's not, you know, we're not all going to be coming from your typical nuclear family structure where you're a mum and dad, 2.5 kids and a dog. A lot of us are not raised that way. A lot of us don't come from backgrounds that are raised that way. And so the notions of what we think are very big and dominating ideas and relationships are not going to be the same. I think for a lot of people, it just began to realize that not only is it like all important that we're going to be connected to like the elder members of our family, but a lot of us are going to be retirement plans for our parents. A lot of us are going to be aged care homes for our grandparents. And that's it. That's a given. That's something that we are already accustomed to. We come from big families where maybe 3-4 generations are already living under one roof. And for the life of them, it was just not connecting as to why we would be living like that, but then also in a low socioeconomic area. And I think this piece, along with the other major reporting styles, really hit back at the time in being like, well, if this is something that you're really grappling with, maybe we should look deeper as to why Sydney is set out this way. Why is it that we've got really high concentrations of families that are built in that structure that are living in specifically one side of Sydney? Why is it that low socioeconomic status is so concentrated in like the furthest parts from the CBD? Why did it take hold and stick around in Western Sydney so quickly? Well, then maybe we need to look at the kind of infrastructure or the lack thereof in health, in transport, in jobs, housing, etc., social services. And why is that, again, concentrated the further you're out from the CBD and sources of power and money in the state, essentially? So I think when it comes to writing from a personal angle, which I tend not to do, but every now and then I think, especially then, it was important to contextualize it, because news can be very detached. And of course, you're getting like people's perspectives and you're covering their personal struggles. But when it comes to you as a journalist, you kind of shy away from it, or you tend to avoid it, because not that it's going to cloud your objectivity per se or your impartiality, but I guess, or at least for me personally, I don't want to be part of the story. But then just seeing what was happening, and based on the kind of feedback I was getting behind the scenes, they thought that I could possibly put this in a way that would reach the audience and at least make sense for people to try and attempt to translate what was happening. One of the more interesting reactions that came from that article was that it got sent to, or it came back to me that my article had reached like this group, or like this like growing amount of like Muslim men around my age, which was interesting. And one of the two main points that came out of that was like, wow, I didn't know that was happening in my own household. Like, that's really intense. Which also makes a lot of sense, because I feel like, again, in these kinds of immigrant households, the dynamics between sons and daughters and how they're treated and how their relationships with their parents are formed are very distinct and very different. So it would make sense that they would be oblivious to what's happening, or that it was just something that's in the background that they didn't take notice of. And then there was this other opinion that was like, well, you could say that this is definitely happening for eldest sons as well. I'm just interested to know as to why you didn't include that. Again, this was a personal article. I'm not a man. I don't know how to write a personal angle from something that I am not. I thought that was a given, but that just made me laugh. And again, if it's going to be a personal article, I can only write from what I have lived and gone through. But I could also say that while that is true to an extent, it's going to be different. The pressures and the kind of responsibilities and expectations that eldest sons will have is not going to be the same as eldest daughters. Like, there's a socialization there and a lot of gender dynamics that go in their favor that don't apply to women. And so I just welcomed the guy to be like, well, if you feel that that's missing, you're more than welcome to go ahead and write about it, bro. Go ahead and do it. I'll just stick to what I know over here in this one instance.
I think you touched on really good points, especially, I guess, the different dynamics and the stresses that, you know, essentially Muslim community goes through, or even, you know, people of different backgrounds go through, especially during lockdown. Naturally, you know, income level, you're sort of relying on, what, in Sydney context, $750 from Centrelink, and people, you know, with different jobs maybe making a lot more than that. And as on top of that, it's like, they may have responsibilities in terms of providing for family back home. I know in many contexts, like, that's to be the case. And so, and if they're unable to make that sort of level of income, you know, stresses and, you know, tensions arise. There's so much to unpack there. And so, to add to that, and I know it's a bit of a turn, but it's just kind of flowing on from what I were discussing, and this is a kind of a discussion that was happening within social media, is that essentially, you know, there was a big moment where during lockdown there was a huge protest happening in the city, and, you know, I think roughly 100,000 people came out to protest. There was that whole tension that essentially, look, one was like, oh, they're all anti-vaxxers and, you know, bad people not following the law, and look at them, you know, not following the law, and, you know, they're just all bad and whatever. And then there's the other camp. There's probably other camps, but these two come to mind. The other one was essentially like, look, you know, these are struggling, like, immigrant communities, or even struggling, you know, it doesn't even have to be like, you know, second, third generation, etc. And, you know, they have these stresses and pressures, and so lockdown has been overbearing, you know, businesses has been struggling, and hence why, you know, it comes to a point where they you know, the bubble bursts, and this is essentially the result of that, because of the hard lockdowns. And so what's your sort of take in that of that situation? Do you boil it down to, you know, just, oh yeah, anti-vaxxers, or do you boil it down to actually kind of continuing on from the discussion that we're having now, is that, look, you know, these communities are struggling, and so they wanted to, you know, make their voices heard because they felt like their voices weren't being heard because, you know, they've been struggling from, I guess, financial standpoint and just other stresses, mental health, etc. So
yeah, it's always an interesting question when it comes to protests, I guess, because there were so many of them, and some are still, like, happening occasionally, more so in Melbourne than in Sydney. But what I always try to look at is the reasons as to why that they're protesting. And specifically during the Sydney lockdown as well, it was being contextualized in a lot of different ways because of the demographic that was there. And I wouldn't say majority were, like, from an immigrant background at all. No, what was interesting about it was that a lot of that came from like the more dominant Anglo population. It kind of spanned a lot of, you know, tax brackets, socioeconomic status, and a lot of the reasons as to why people protested became very apparent. I know some basically did it because they were just in opposition to lockdown at all, because they saw it as an infringement upon their freedoms. Some was probably anti-vaccination at the time. And then some were basically just trying to highlight the actual impact that lockdown has. But I just wonder, I think in the coverage, the questions then arise about how even though you'd think that this is, like, an expression of said opinions in a quote-unquote public forum, whether the fact that because it's happening in a COVID context, whether protests like that really carry any weight, right? Because I think when you compare these kind of protests happening in a post-COVID era to, say, ones that have a more unified message, like Black Lives Matter, or any kind of, like, environmentalist or sustainability politics, like during the COP26 summit earlier this year, I felt personally that those were more profound and more impactful in terms of freedom of expression, as opposed to the COVID or anti-lockdown or anti-vax protests, because with those kind of protests, there is also a political angle that is happening, or the political angle is being projected onto those kind of protests, in that they're probably encouraged by certain factions of, say, like, you know, right-wing factions of the Liberal Party or the Coalition or the Nationals, or they may have been inspired by actual right-wing groups, and the rest kind of just joined in. And like the you're mobilizing in a way, but in a way that is permissible or at least allowed by like these figureheads, that you're able to get away with it. So I think it just, to me, it's like it's whether it's actually diminishing the whole purpose of a protest, because a protest is the whole point of a protest is that you are trying to express a message or send through what you think against a specific arm or source of power, right? You are speaking up to power because there's a power dynamic happening, and this power is almost always political because those are the opinions. Like, no one's going to be protesting against the Reserve Bank, you know what I mean? Like, it's going to be either be companies or governments or that kind of thing. When you have a silent or even the not so silent cosign from people in power that you have a right to express your dissatisfaction at how lockdowns are being run or whether vaccines should be mandated at all in school or work settings, or that, you know, people have a right to be angry about the way that this is impacting your business, is it really effective as a protest? That's the question mark, right? Because again, and what these COVID protests had really exposed is specifically for the coalition this year is that they're not interested in alienating this group of people. They're really not. They're really counting on their votes in the upcoming federal election. So why would you demonize those protests, except for the fact of when, you know, violence is used and they're actually damaging public property, etc., like what happened with in Melbourne and the Shrine of Remembrance and whatnot. When it gets to that point, that's when you hear the condemnation. But I guess it's just exposed a very interesting dynamic that is going to have quite an impact come next year.
On the topic of protests, it's interesting because even during, aside from like, I guess, protests in regards to COVID, even during COVID, there was the whole BLM protest. Also, we had the Palestinian activism. And so there's a lot to discuss there, because when the whole BLM situation, George Floyd situation occurred, it was, you know, it was really good sentiment on the ground, especially during the protests. When I went there, there was a lot of support and a lot of talk. And not only that, there was also talk about, you know, awareness being shown for, you know, Aboriginal, for the Aboriginal community, etc., which is all very important. But, you know, me and another good friend of mine, we were just discussing, like, you know, there's the protest shows that there's a lot of sentiment and people want to, you know, raise these issues. And, you know, as you mentioned, rightly so, in terms of speaking back to power. But within also that, it's like, you know, after the protest kind of finished and you have like police there sort of, you know, managing the situation, it's like, how far can you actually go? It's like, after this all, you know, dies down, which we anticipate, obviously, like within the next 2-3 days, life just slowly, you know, goes back to normal and, you know, things run the normal course, etc. It's like, I don't know, like post the protest, it's like, you know, what have we actually, like, this is from our own sort of personal perspective. It's like, have people really been, you know, educated about this? Are people making like specific differences? Maybe they're doing it, I'm just not maybe seeing it. And so I guess these questions sort of came to mind. And on top of that, there's the other question from the Islamic epistemology in the sense of, like, you know, sometimes the sort of approach when it comes to multiculturalism is very like liberal one. And so naturally there's that kind of conflict and contradiction when you're in those sort of spaces. So that's another conversation as well. And especially on top of that, it's like, I know I'm saying a lot because these are like a lot of my thoughts, but like on top of that, there's the Palestinian situation that occurred, you know, the Israel conflict. And there was, you know, mashallah on the ground, there was a lot of support. I really, you know, I know you were there as well at the protests, if I recall. And, you know, just the amount of, you know, Islamic sentiment on the ground, it was really great to see, not going to lie. So from that perspective, it was great. Alhamdulillah. And I know that there was a lot of change in terms of, I guess, the media's coverage to it. And so I know I said a lot, maybe we can touch on the whole kind of, you know, aspect of, you know, being Muslim within those spaces, how that you run into, naturally run into conflicts, and that kind of showed on Clubhouse. And I really like got wind, I guess, when you have, you know, different people in kind of different ideological leanings have arguments about with you in regards to these issues. It's like, wait, we're not actually like as united as we think we are in these specific issues. But aside from that, maybe we can have that conversation a bit later on the show. But I also wanted to ask from a general perspective, like how much of all these protests have you seen really shape and influence how media is, you know, media covers these issues? Or have you seen real on the ground impact when it comes to news corporations and how they cover these sort of news now? Because people obviously make the point that, like, you know, people the media is more you know, cushy with Israel and won't really highlight, you know, the Palestinian struggle in the way that it should be, obviously. And so naturally there was a tide shifting, because I did pay attention to the ABC and the SBS sort of news coverage of it. You could see like that tide shifting, but I just wanted to also get from your perspective, in what ways have these protests really, you know, allowed for these to really, you know, highlight these issues for what they are, and how did the media cover them, and yeah, what impact it had on media in general?
Okay, there's a whole bunch of questions here that we're going to need to break down, because I felt like there were five or six questions in there and now I'm unsure as to where to start. But I guess I'll try and start at the beginning, and then you're just going to have to re-ask them as you go along. But you asked, your first question was whether protests are actually meaningful and achieving anything in particular, at least in an Australian context. And I think the first thing that we need to point out is that protests are not a long-term solution to the problems that they're trying to highlight. They're, if you think of them as flares or literal flag waving to just basically bring attention to an issue, then that's where it serves its purpose. Anyone who thinks that protests are going to deliver actual long-term reform in terms of laws or policy decisions or court proceedings or, you know, draft of like legislation, then there's no translation between what is happening at a protest versus what's happening there. And I think people really conflate the two and think that just because something isn't protested means that the issue has somehow died or has become irrelevant again. And I think maybe people aren't particularly aware, or maybe like digitally literate, in how to follow up or keep track of what's happening in terms of an issue, because a protest is like the most, you could say, like the most exciting thing visually and emphatically speaking, because of the mobilization of people and the emotions that are running behind it, and the passion that it speaks to an issue. But you need to translate that momentum into something that's going to be happening both in the short term and long term. So if we're just going to be using protests as a mechanism, then that's not going to be effective at all in bringing attention to an issue, or at least trying to solve an issue. So when it comes to the Black Lives Matter protests, it was very much happening in an Australian context. Like, I think it's not really just bringing awareness to what's happening in Australia. No, what happened was the BLM movement was used specifically for the Indigenous lens to bring our own version of George Floyd, which was David Dungay, who has, like, that's that would be like an actual mobilization of an issue, like really trying to connect it to what's happening here. So if you're going to translate what BLM was happening or like has been happening in Australia, it would mean the Royal Commission into Aboriginal deaths in custody, which for the past 25 years has led to 400 deaths. Like, that's like, that is something that is now thinking long term, because there was an actual, well, actually 400 deaths have happened since the Royal Commission had happened. So now you've got something where it's been spanning long term that actually has a point to make, that actually needs to be a policy decision that needs to address these preventable deaths in custody. You have the actual, like an actual police officer in the Northern Territory being tried for killing an Aboriginal teenager that is been permitted by the High Court to continue despite the many attempts to have this kind of put down as a measure in self-defense. That hasn't happened. Well, that's very rare to happen in Australia as well. Are people aware enough to connect that to either an impact of the movement or just a shift in sentiment because of that? So again, I think when it comes to protests, we need to think a lot more laterally and in terms of longevity about a situation. Because if we're just going to be using protests as benchmarks for how far we've progressed collectively as a society, then they're not really good benchmarks at all, right? Another way that you could probably say that protests are at least effective and moving, and remember, like, I think another thing that assists protests as well is that because now a lot of the discussion is happening online and in social media, in the lead up to a protest, there's conversations and movements that have been building for weeks. It's not like, oh, something happened, we need to mobilize now. Like, within the American context, Black Lives Matter protests technically started in 2016. So it's been a 5-year-long conversation in the making, but really it's been a 400-year-long conversation, you know, in the terms of the US context, because of police treatment and brutality towards African American populations is very much entrenched in their history. But if you're going to look at it like that, then you've got a longer term view of what has been happening on the ground in terms of how they're lobbying politicians, how this has become an election issue, that kind of thing. One way that you could probably see protests as well as being somewhat effective is the shift that we're having, especially in Australia, around climate change and, more importantly, taking specific action towards it now. We are now at a point collectively where environmentalism and sustainability is being taken seriously. And what I mean seriously is that the coalition, and specifically the National Party and the Liberal Party, have now been left no choice but to act, because they've realized that the rest of the country has now caught up with the rest of the world in realizing that this is a decisive issue. This is one that's being taken to the polls, but this is one where sentiment across age groups and populations has now completely shifted to being like, oh, we are collectively in the danger zone. If we don't do anything now, our kids will have nothing left. That kind of thing. And for the Liberal Party to actually take on to that and be held to task, especially the Morrison government and Scott Morrison in particular, being embarrassed so thoroughly on the international stage by people like Boris Johnson, out of all politicians to drag you over the coals over your inactive climate policy, and being ostracized because of your unwillingness to commit to anything or interact, that you needed to leave the summit a week early, now speaks volumes. That would have never, like, that would have never been something that, like, a Liberal government would have concerned itself with 5 years ago, even 10 years ago, definitely, but like 5 years ago, that would have never happened at all. But now we're at a completely different, like, we're at a completely different point, collectively speaking. And again, protests are not the benchmark that we're using to push this, but it's about the continuous discussions around it. It's about moving it in terms of making it a policy issue. It's about putting forward, like, legislation, holding companies to account, using a big thing, again, with this, that I, like, obviously that the BLM movement does not have, is that there is a consumer power that is very much attached to environmentalism, in that sustainability is now profitable. So you actually have the power as a consumer to take your dollars away from companies that support forced labor, that overpollute, that don't recycle and are basically filling up entire countries with their landfill, and take it towards actual initiatives and companies that do center, like, their entire business plan on it. Like, there's something attachable now and something tangible that is really shifting where consumers want to be. Like, now we've got this rise of what we call, like, the ethical consumer, right? And I feel like they've caught up to us in one way, in terms of things like ethical super funds. It's like, no, I don't want to be funding war, and we're over here being like, oh, we've never wanted to do that at all with our super, but, like, welcome to the club. But there is this rise in the consumer that wants to be completely informed about the supply chain top down. Like, they don't want to invest their money into anything that will support forced Uyghur labor. They don't want to support anything that is, you know, contributing to the Amazon being reduced to ashes. They don't want to buy anything that's made out of harmful plastics. They don't want to buy into anything that will lead to, like, the use of fossil fuels. The rise of the electric car is profitable for that reason, and they've just caught on to it. And what I mean by they is actual governments have just caught on to it. So, in a very roundabout way, hopefully I've detailed how protests are just like a flashpoint. What's really happening behind the scenes is a lot more meaningful and a lot more important in terms of how these issues are regarded and progressed in that way.
And what about in terms of, especially with protests and how media corporations address these issues? Like, what sort of differences have you noted within within, for example, the whole BLM movement, and also within the Palestinian issues as well?
Yeah, so news corporations, again, I think I've mentioned this before in a different podcast, but I think a lot of the protests are obviously going to be at least challenging, editorially speaking, for corporations to cover. On the topic of environmentalism, I don't know if you've noticed, but Murdoch Media decided this year that they were actually going to take like a more decisive lens towards climate change and climate activism. And they set themselves a goal to be more accurate and make this like a fundamental issue that they want to inform their readers on. And the reason why that announcement had everyone else in the media industry clutching their pearls in a chokehold, but in a not in a, oh my God, I can't believe they did that kind of way, but almost sardonically speaking, because the Murdoch media has been one of, if not the most opposing media corporation in terms of even giving it that time of day. And if it was, it was basically assisting in any way, shape or form towards the demise of any progression towards respectable climate politics. And in its entire history, it has always been pro-fossil fuel, pro-mining, and would basically continue down that line. And some would say have been instrumental in helping dismantle a lot of the attempts towards climate policy. And if whoever is familiar with Australian politics would really know that for the past 25 years or so, climate policy has been the defining issue in every single Australian election, in that no matter what kind of progression or positive take you wanted to go in terms of trying to do something about it, has always been a surefire fail, which is what Labor has been grappling with and has really became apparent during the Rudd-Gillard era, with any kind of attempt was basically written off as a climate tax by the Abbott opposition, and then that became the Abbott government. And that also led to Malcolm Turnbull's demise as well, because although he was liberal, you could say he was more moderate and very much more environmentally conscious, and again tried to put forward policy, was backstabbed by his own party for it. So climate policy has been an issue that a lot of governments have lost on, and a lot of that is because when it comes to the liberal and moderate to right politics, Murdoch media caters, or a lot of Murdoch media caters to that audience. It has the largest audience in Australia in terms of actual paying audiences, and that is the perspective that reaches them, because you're dealing with a lot of regional communities, you're dealing with a lot of backing from mining magnates and companies and whatnot. So to do anything that would be antithetical to that is not something that would make much sense profit-wise for them. But now the tide has officially shifted with that announcement this year that they were going to take climate policy seriously. And it was almost like a pseudo-apology, but not, which is why it had the rest of the media industry shocked. Because in Murdoch media, a lot of the time that is spent being very anti-ABC and SBS is because for so long, the public broadcasters have always had this editorial policy to stick to quote-unquote like clear science. And so because it scientifically made sense that climate change was happening for so long, that is the line that they took. And that was, you know, that's where the whole left-leaning greeny kind of bashing line came from. And so for them to flip the switch and tell their own audience, hey, we may have missed the mark here for a long time, we're going to need to get this right, speaks volumes. And that'll be very interesting to see how this is going to manifest come this election, because climate policy is definitely going to be a key issue again, of course. And so seeing that balance of power now and how that's going to play out is going to be something that all media is going to be paying attention to with like a razor sharp eye, especially that point. But when it comes to, again, with other protests like the Palestine protests against the forced removal of families, well, it begun with the forced removal of families in Sheikh Jarrah, and basically the eviction of families who have lived in Jerusalem and other parts of Palestine for generations. Again, there was a point of opinion that had changed, and I don't know, again, if you were aware as well, but it was another big shift in the Australian media industry that played out very, very interestingly, and again, I don't think would have been possible 5 or 10 years ago. And that really begun with, and I think what really kicked it off again as well, is that the Black Lives Matter movement helped contextualize the quote-unquote Palestine-Israel conflict to a whole new generation. And it was contextualized in a way that it could no longer be ignored, if that made sense, right? Because the big thing that BLM achieved in both in an Australian context and globally as well, because I don't think that there has been this much support for the Palestinian movement in such a long time, especially online. And the reason why that is because Black Lives Matter gave people the language and the tools to understand societal structures of power, right? Police brutality isn't just like a cute coin term. People have now begun to realize that, hang on, this is an executive arm of government, which means they actually get funding for this, and this is how it's set up, and this is how it ties into other forms of government and power. And oh my God, what kind of structure is this? This is borderline oppressive, if not oppressive already. There are no checks and balances. What is going on here? They were able to take that understanding and apply it to an entire country. And that's when a lot of dots connected for a lot of people. Because, again, and another thing that I think helped it is the context of Sheikh Jarrah itself was like the perfect case study for people to apply this new understanding to, because it had been a year at that point, right? It had been a year that people had really come to terms with, or at least the audience had come to terms with, understanding and mulling over and having it like sit and be like, okay, I'm now being able to detect this locally. And so when they see it to a conflict, or a quote-unquote conflict, but when they see it to the ever classical Middle East crisis that for so long has been set as one narrative, BLM basically challenged that to the core for so many people. So, and when I mean by so many people, I mean like this time around, I saw a lot of, you could say quote unquote liberal Jews, but a lot of the Jewish population, especially in the, like in the UK and in the United States, had a lot of, at least this is what I'm seeing on TikTok, had a lot of like uncomfortable realizations about, you know, their position on birthright trips and what their family had been telling them versus what had been playing out on the ground, right? So I think there was no other way that you could have possibly spun this. These families were minding their own business, living in their own homes, in their own land, and the amount of footage, both from social media and from what happened afterwards in the escalation with the attacks on Gaza, even though the Hamas line again was basically followed down. And it's something that's like, it's unavoidable at that point. You're not just going to say Hamas didn't do anything. But again, it's one of those points that I constantly repeated in that Hamas is listed as a terrorist organization in a lot of countries, I think Australia included. And so because it has that designation, it's going to attract that kind of editorial perspective. It's almost a given. But even then, that excuse or that line of narrative per se isn't going to hold up when, you know, an entire building that housed Al Jazeera and the Associated Press was destroyed for no reason. Given, and with a lot of the casualties as well of, you know, people and children who had died in that escalation, that response to that escalation of violence, again, with that understanding of BLM, has just hit home for a lot of people. And the cherry on top was the lack of explanation from the Israeli government as to why they destroyed any media access going into Gaza. And I think that was the point where I was like, okay, especially in Australia, we have a very strong and robust pro-Israel lobby that has been very much known. But this was the first time ever, I think, that we had very definitive action and positions taken from either journalists themselves or from whole media organizations to basically stand their ground and challenge editorial narratives, where not only journalists here but around the world had begun campaigning for the right to present more balanced coverage of what was happening in Jerusalem and Gaza. And what they meant by more balanced was, hey, can we just tell it like it is? Like, this is what's happening. It can't be spun any other way. And it had interesting ramifications here and overseas as well. Overseas, I know that one of the things that had come up actually was this young journalist by the name of Emily Wilder had just started working with Associated Press at the time, which is ironic because, remember, they had their entire office blown up. And she lost her job because of the fact that even though she herself was Jewish, she had been part of her university life, had been part of campus societies that were reportedly pro-Palestinian. The Israel lobby got a whiff of that and basically campaigned for her to be fired from her job, and it worked. The problem was that went viral. And so that just exposed a whole can of worms. Following from that, other things kind of started beginning to snowball. I know that in the CBC, or like the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation, I think there was like a collective letter from the union there asking their organization for more balanced coverage. A couple of other organizations did it as well. Here at home, I think The Guardian Australia put out a collective like letter as an organization saying that they did not agree with the way that the Palestine issue had been portrayed and presented for a long time. And so as a part of championing independent journalism would be advocating and pushing for better coverage. And we were all like, whoa, this is nuts. This is actually insane. I don't think there has ever been such like a force, like foreseeable stance on this ever. And this was happening in tandem with a letter set out by former journalist Janine Khalek, who it had amassed, like, I don't know how many signatures it had amassed, but I want to say it's probably close to 700, 800, around that, which is huge. But the actual ramifications of that, especially from like a public broadcaster perspective, was very interesting because SBS in particular took such a hard line to that they were chasing down their own journalists who had signed that open letter and allegedly, according to the union, threatened them with them losing their jobs if they did not rescind their signature. And really what is happening behind the scenes here is that, and especially in these newsrooms, is that it's not like these people don't know what's going on. They know what's going on. And the frustration is there. But what is outgrowing the frustration is the fear of upsetting the lobby groups. And you might think it was like, okay, well, that's a bit cowardly. Why on earth would you take such a line? When you're a public broadcaster, whether it's the ABC or SBS, if your funding comes from the public purse, you are not at liberty to make such stances the same way other organizations are. You're the one that's subjected to Senate estimates. Your funding can be revoked at any moment. If there are any government officials that want to come for your neck, they can. And specifically, I mean, in the ABC context, it didn't happen to the same extent because, and I'll touch on later on, our actual head of investigations, John Lyons, released a book later this year that fully exposed like the state that the Australian media industry is in terms of power. It's like the most comprehensive tell-all, like the names that he dropped, the instances that he talked about. He specifically canvassed how Janine, as a Palestinian journalist, was basically chased out of the profession, literally bullied and harassed out of the profession by the Israel lobby. If you have not had a chance to read it or follow it up, highly suggest you do. If not, there are like excerpts on Janine's Twitter, and they're like 12 pages or so that really capture how this is all playing out in Australian media. But when it comes to the ABC in particular, there had to be a fine line that was followed up because, again, the ABC was in hot water due to the whole Christian Porter, Brittany Higgins situation. There was a defamation action at the time where he was suing the public broadcaster. So it's like, how much hot water can an organization take for reporting and for its journalism? So it's a very complicated balancing act that's happening. In saying that, the push towards better coverage is at least happening, and I think is just going to continue on this trajectory, especially if like the whole curtain has been lifted. And the only way this could have happened is through these protest movements, because it's now, even though they're just a flashpoint, it's uncovering and forcing the media to realize that there's no hiding from these issues anymore, and that the audience is really now asking them to deliver on that promise.
Mashallah, that was a lot said there and really good points you touched on. And I guess essentially, I think near the beginning you were mentioning about BLM, and I guess the impact it has made. I think without a doubt, it's been immense, even to the point where, when I sort of tune out of discussing things to do with, activism or Islam or deen and whatnot, I flick on, sports and, watch cricket or soccer or football. Now you can see straight away, even in cricket during the World Cup, they'll take the knee before they start actually playing. Football, the same thing. They take the knee. It's like flown on, like it's made such an impact that it's like being, done within sport as well. And I guess the natural sentiment beforehand used to be like, politics and sport don't, intertwine or mix. And now I think
But
that
sport is so political.
exactly, yeah.
Sport to me, which is what I find so fascinating about it, apart from it itself, I mean, I absolutely love soccer, but the thing that I find so intriguing about it is how politics manifests itself in sport because it's the ultimate symbol. Any issues that are playing out can be summarized in a particular sport. Like one thing extrapolated from an incident in sport can speak volumes to so many things. And no matter how much people try to limit it and be like, this is just for the game, we're all here because we love the game and we're here for sportsmanship and blah, blah, blah. No, everything about it is political. Whether it comes to, what side a player or what team a player decides to sign up for, what nationality they decide to compete under, which tournaments they will or won't be attending, whether they're blackballed or blacklisted, like so many things can be extrapolated from that.
Yeah, definitely. And I guess, however, in the wider Australian community, they try to portray, I'm talking about specifically in our context, they try to portray it as like, no, we don't want politics in sport. But obviously we know it's happening in the sense that even during there was this weird situation where, not really weird, but I think it exposes that, sport is political, but the way that I guess from the white perspective, it's like they want to portray that, no, it's never been sort of like that. But however, it's like when the whole Taliban situation happened and Cricket Australia had this test match happening with Afghanistan, and they actually like postponed, or I don't know if they either postponed or cancelled it. It was meant to happen, I think, this month in December. They either postponed or cancelled it because they were like, oh, obviously they knew, obviously, everyone, there's that Australian kind of public sentiment in terms of how they view Taliban in regards to, especially how they view the Australian troops and how they fought for our country, etc. So there's this kind of emotional attachment when it comes to, Australia in Afghanistan and fighting the forces of evil, etc. And essentially, when the whole Taliban thing unfolded, I think what essentially happened was Cricket Australia wanted to back out of it, or actually got advised by the Australian government in order to, postpone or cancel that sort of test match. And so Australia, Cricket Australia came out randomly, said like, we won't play them until they support women's cricket in Afghanistan, which is really random and strange. It's just out of the blue. And I guess people mo noted, like, hopefully I don't have to make it clear that, we're all, we support, women's education, all that's kind of stating the obvious. But I guess when it gets used, or that specific issue gets instrumentalized to make a to use it as a point of like kind of perpetuating that sort of Islamophobic narrative, I think that's where, I'm gonna disagree, in the sense that they didn't want to, essentially it's, the funny point someone made a note of it is like women's cricket in Afghanistan haven't been playing all this time, even when, the Americans were occupying Afghanistan. So it was a bit of a hypocrisy kind of coming out randomly and being like, oh nah, like, we want women's cricket to be supported. And it's like, but even when the Americans were in, when Ashraf Ghani was there, it's not like it was being supported there anyway. So why are you using this issue selectively for this specific specific context in order to get out? Because, it's basically the whole Taliban situation. Point is like, my long-winded point is that you can see how sports being politicized in this situation, right? and how that plays out, and kind of exposes the kind of Islamophobic narrative or sentiments within your white Australian community. That's very normalized in that sense, where they won't, you know, highlight issues for what they are. And so essentially at times, to me, I guess it became evident that when people are saying, you know, sports, you know, politics and sports shouldn't mix, and like make those sort of comments, it's more so speaking to power in the sense that, you know, they don't want to actually highlight those main issues that are occurring potentially in the context of BLM. Because I think there was another, it's become a sports podcast for some reason, but it's tied to politics. So I don't know if you can hear, it's really loud in my background. But yeah, so Quinton de Kock, from South African batsman, very popular, very good player. He didn't take the knee during the World Cup, and there was a lot of discussion around that, and a lot of controversy, especially, you know, in the context of being
you mean the Australian cricket team controversy wasn't enough for you this week at all?
There's always controversy, no? Yeah.
Mm.
But yeah, so there was that whole situation in terms of, I guess the point is now, especially with the specific BLM situation, now, you know, someone not taking the knee, you know, there's huge ramifications in that sense. And I guess that speaks to how strong the sentiments are in regards to these specific issues. But I didn't actually understand Quinton de Kock's rationale. It's really weird because, like, I don't know, he gave the reason that, all lives matter, etc. That's why I didn't take all that. Like, it didn't honestly make sense. But yeah, you have that kind of strong sentiment within even sports now, which is, I'm not like, it's good to see, right? These issues being played. But I guess,
and remember, like, this has been, is in the Australian context, it's, you have these positive ramifications now, but with specific context to BLM, this has been happening since Adam Good's retirement. It's just now that Australia, well, I'm not sure whether Australia has now reached a level of acceptance, but at least it's normalized now, versus when Adam Goods and later on Heretier Lumumba from the AFL tried to bring these issues up back when BLM had first become mainstream, circa 2016, the amount of backlash and damage to their careers that these two men took was really a bullet for the rest of the industry. Because fast forward to that, you had last year an entire documentary breaking down what had happened to this man towards
Walid Ali was, if I recall, he was the interviewer.
Oh, yes.
And that was controversy there, how he handled that situation, yep. Right?
There has been no apology to date, but the project had deleted that interview from its web archive, so you can't even find it online. At least on there, you definitely can find it on YouTube, for sure. But there's actual ramifications for it. But basically, there's never been a point in time in an Australian context or otherwise where sport has never been political. It's always political, every single time.
Yeah, if someone makes it, I think it's clear if someone makes the point that, oh, no, it's not meant to be political, I think it's like racism, or they just don't see the blatant racism. Because, yeah, like with the whole Adam Good situation, that was like wild, especially how, you know, the sort of struggles and the way he had to endure, especially like, you know, monkey chants and all that sort of stuff. That's, it was such a big like issue. And I guess, what was it, Eddie Maguire?
And it was like, yeah, it's exactly Eddie Maguire. It was so, the problem was that the racism was so institutionalized that at the time, what he was saying had no weight, and it looked like he had just ended his career on a sour note. But once the Australian public had, again, gotten used to that idea and had it normalized, when you watch it back years later, right, because I think the documentary did come out last year, there was a completely different response. Completely different response to what he'd went to. And that's, I think, the most ironic thing when it comes to sport and politics is that, with the benefit of hindsight, these players don't really get the justice or support that they deserve until well after the fact, right? But by then it's too late, for them anyway. For the next generation, you'd hope that you've set them up so that the same mistakes wouldn't be repeated. That's a question for another day, but it seems to always happen with the benefit of hindsight in mind.
Yeah, and it's really interesting with sport as well. There was a really big news coming out, even from England cricket, where Azeem Rafiq pretty much, I guess, like, it makes it easier. Like, I guess, like, especially, like, for example, the Me Too movement, when it was happening, it became a platform or a way for, I guess, more women to come out and talk about, you know, situations that they've endured that was otherwise, you know, difficult to speak about beforehand. And I guess now, especially, I guess, in this specific context with BLM, that's allowed people to kind of come out and talk about racism. And yeah, Azeem Rafiq was a huge news as well, very global, even to the point where Jordan Pearson made this dumb clip about his thoughts on racism, institutionalized racism. But yeah, so Azeem Rafiq, like, he was I think it was Pakistani background, but like English cricketer, and Yorkshire, he basically played for Yorkshire for a period of time in his cricket career, and he basically called out, he came out and called out, like, Yorkshire Cricket Club, the sort of racism that happened there, specific people he also called out. To the point where, because I think he also alluded, like, directly mentioned that, you know, the racism was so much to the point where it really, like, mentally, you know, scarred him in many, many ways. And so he came out after, like, there's a lot of national cricket players are affiliated with Yorkshire Cricket Club. And so he came out just kind of, you know, calling them out, saying, like, there was one very prominent cricketer, his name's skipping my mind, played for England. Oh, Michael Vaughan, sorry. I think he made a comment like, there's too many of you in looking at all the, like, you know, subcontinental players within the team, kind of looked at them or pointed at them saying, you know, there's too many of you coming into this country, or something to that effect. And like, it wasn't even just like that one off, it was like many other instances. And we know, like, especially, like, I'll give a personal example, right? Because I think it's really difficult to really talk about these issues if someone hasn't been through it and really, you know, get others to understand. Because, like, mm-hmm. I also endured it myself, in the sense that it wasn't like blatant racism, but when I played in certain cricket clubs here, because the structure, like, you know, a lot of basically all the, you know, the higher ups and everyone, they have like ties with this kind of sponsorships, and they have like, they're basically a white club, to put it bluntly, right? And so when you have like a few people that are either like Muslim or culturally, you know, from a different background, like, you know, from the subcontinent, etc., in my case, because I had like three other mates, we joined the club after high school. Basically what happened, right, they were like, oh, you know, after the game you have to come down to the sponsorship place, which is basically like a pub, right? But it's not, it's a club, but there's a pub in it. And they're like, oh, come mm-hmm. down, hang out. We're like,
yep.
But we're Muslim. They're like, no, you don't have to drink this and that. I'm like, it's like, you have to explain to the white guy, like, your principles and values, and then they'll look at you weird. And I guess this isn't just in the sporting context, it can happen in the workplace, etc., right? Which I've also encountered myself. But I guess in the cricket context, it's like, you got to explain away, and then all they view it as is like, oh, you're just trying to not come at all costs. And or maybe they have this perception that you're just antisocial, but really it's against your principles mm-hmm. as a Muslim, right? And yeah, I had like bad situations. And not only, aside from that, like, I was still like, at that time I was like 19 or 18, and so, you know, there's that kind of cultural disconnect where it's like they don't understand that, especially from, you know, most background, different backgrounds, like, I guess, migrant communities, you know, when parents are on the slightly stricter side in terms of when coming back home and all this sort of stuff, it's like a big deal, right? And so they just had mm-hmm. They had no regard for that. So
there's no reference point.
Yeah, exactly. And so it's like, you know, your hands are tied. It's like, you know, what do you do? And so eventually, like, it didn't work out. I played for them, like, I think two seasons or so. And, you know, I had to part ways because it wasn't, you know, I guess the only person that could really fit in from the same background as me is if pretty much they were like into that kind of, you know, social drinking kind of environment and all that. And it was set up for me to lose, essentially, right? And yeah, so I eventually had to leave that club, etc. But yeah, point is like, we can see the ramifications or to the degree of, you know, this can affect players. And I can assume for even in Azeem Rafiq's case, it's like more heightened, right? Because it's like higher stakes, big players around you, you know what I mean? And so like he would have had to undergo like a lot of pressure, a lot of anxiety in the process. And so he came out kind of blasting, you know, Yorkshire Cricket Club and how they set things up. And it was really fascinating, really like strange as well. It's like there was this kind of quote-unquote, I think, like internal investigation in terms of seeing if there's actually institutionalized racism within the club. And I think like I made a tweet or I posted something like, you're telling a white club to investigate institutionalized racism within a white club, like what the heck, like, you know what I mean? It's like you're not going to get anywhere. Obviously it's going to be like, no, like, you know, I don't see or whatever, right? Because it's like they don't have that kind of lived reality, right, or lived experiences. And so yeah, there's so much to unpack there in terms of, you know, the degree of racism. And I guess now it's interesting. I guess there's that kind of approach of like now we're on eggshells almost when it comes to these issues and we have to be more aware. I don't know. Maybe there's that kind of discussion about the excesses, if you may call it that, in that sense, right? But all in all, you know, these issues are definitely making strides and impacts, and we can see it, you know, play out in sport as well. But it's really weird because it's like the people that Azeem Rafiq kind of accused, you know, those players, like, you know, I think Michael Vaughan, he sort of, you know, denied it even, and all this kind of like almost gaslighting, which is really disgusting as well. So, yeah, it's a shame, but yeah, even however, in saying that, it's good to see like the other players that came out are, you know, not coincidentally, they just happen to be, you know, people of the same background as him, like Adil Rashid, who actually plays for England. He even came out supporting Azeem Rafiq, saying, no, I've heard this sort of stuff being said around the club, right? And so it's like the only people that are sort of supporting him, I guess, is people of his own background, which is, you know.
Of course. I mean, and you don't have to even look, you don't even have to look that far if you just look at the treatment of the English football team during the Euro 2020s, right? Like what those young boys had to cop was absolutely ridiculous in terms of their performance, because it was immediately attached to their race. And I'm specifically talking about like the black players, like Marcus Rashford, really having to take up. And I felt so bad that he even had to be put in that position. But again, you can't expect these institutions to successfully investigate themselves. That hasn't been more apparent, I think, than in that instance, but also more locally in Parliament as well, with the release of the Jenkins report, because there was no way that you could that Parliament will conduct an independent review into a problem that it perpetuates if you're just going to keep it internal. That's the institution protecting itself. You have to have someone who is linked to that experience in order to give it, oddly enough, a more objective review, which is what happened with the Sex Discrimination Commissioner, Kate Jenkins, basically listing out and calling out and being like, yep, this place is just as gross as you think it is, and everyone knows that it's just as gross as you think it is, and we need to fix this up now. There's no excuse. It's like out in the open.
Yeah, and it becomes difficult as well, because it, like, even their lives or even aspects about who they are just become even more under the microscope. Like, this is pretty much a sports podcast, because like there was this whole there was a lot of discussion in terms of sports pundits and how they criticized Paul Pogba straight away and more quickly in comparison to someone like Harry Kane, who's like, you know, a white, you know, a British striker. who has, you know, great like rapport, I guess, with the wider society. Oh, yeah. And, mm-hmm. you know, his behaviors, because he wanted to, I think, wanted to transfer to Manchester City, but he was acting really, he didn't even rock up to training for Tottenham. And so he was acting in a very strange manner, but none of that got actual criticism. For some reason, like, the commentators were like, oh, you know, he's a nice guy. Like, I'm sure, like, it's not as bad as they think or whatever. But then in the same breath, they're quick to, you know, criticize Paul Pogba and other, you know, players. And especially, yeah, you mentioned Euro 2020. It's like, it was really sad because, you know, Marcus Rashford missed that important penalty. And then he had to, like, you could already sense that it's like people were coming out to, like, you know, come out his throat essentially because of his, mm-hmm. you know, pretty much his background, right? And that's what I mean. Like, it becomes more under the spot. Like, even with, I think, Azeem Rafiq, since he's come out, now people are coming after his, like, personality and, you know, his sort of, you know, attitude, I guess. And yeah, and I think there was one instance where it's like, oh, they're trying to pull up, you know, anti-sentiment tweets that he made or something to that effect. So it's like your whole life just becomes, like, under the spotlight and every, you know, is scrutinized in that manner when it takes away from the actual issue, right? And that's a big problem. And it's like, how do you you know, navigate that in of itself? It becomes really
and the thing is that at the time they know what they're doing in terms of news coverage. It will only be a couple years or a few years down the track where they'll be able to look at it and say, oh, that wasn't right and we need to prevent this from happening in the future, only to do it to the next person, because again, none of these issues are addressed at an institutional level, and it's so much easier to bag out the one individual that's challenging it.
Exactly, yeah. And it becomes something to navigate and something to, because at the end of the day, you do have, you know, those, especially like when we're navigating those, you know, white structures or, you know, structural issues, becomes even more difficult to really discuss these issues for what it is head on, because it gets, you know, you have like even like in instances where you need, like, as you know, rightly put, mashallah, very succinctly, you know, need someone with a similar background to kind of validate what's going on, right? And then
you need an entire support network. It's not just like one other person. You need an actual mobilization for it to happen to be taken seriously. And one of the things that, like, the common thread that's been happening throughout this entire discussion, and I think it links back to a question you asked, like, way earlier about how are we supposed to navigate multiculturalism within a, like, in Islamic epistemology. The thing is that as long as the multiculturalism is not happening within a remotely Islamic context, I don't think you can interpret it or at least apply yourself using, like, Islamic structures to a very specifically, like, non-Islamic problem in that sense, because it's really only going to dictate what you can do as an individual. And I think that's where we get really hung up on it. But, like, back onto that point, you need mobilization. This year as well, if you think back to, again, what was happening with the exposure of the sexist workplace culture in Parliament House, it started out with Brittany Higgins. No, it started out with Rachel Miller last year, towards the end of last year, and then came Brittany Higgins. And then after that, more and more stories came out, right? Then it cascaded into a movement. And then before you know it, you had thousands, hundreds of thousands of women mobilizing, not just in Canberra, but everywhere else around the country to voice their frustration. And then to add on top of that, you had former female MPs, current female MPs, basically all coming out and saying, and when it gets to that such a force, that's when it can't be ignored any longer. Because as sad as it is, You need that one brave person to trigger like a domino effect. And yes, it's so taxing and tolling for that person because Brittany was scrutinized for weeks. Every single thing about her situation is absolutely horrific, and I really commend her for how she has been handling it. It's absolutely incredible what she had to go through. I remember a very specific quote that she said earlier this year is that Parliament was so reluctant and avoided to deal with her at all costs that she was finding out about her own, like, rape allegations and what had happened to her through the media. She's like, I was finding out about my own situation every day at 5:30 a.m. because they wouldn't tell me what happened. I had to find out from the ABC, or I had to find out from news.com. Like, how horrific is that? Like, it's one of the most traumatizing things to happen to a woman, like, ever. One of the most horrific things. And not only do you not know what happened to you for at least a couple of years, but then there are, like, the institution is protecting itself in a way where they won't let you know what happened to you. And it's not, and you only find out with the rest of the country. That's so deeply scarring. I would have no idea of how I would have to deal with that if I had ever been in like a situation like that. But she handled it with such grace as well, because with, along with these other issues that we were talking about, these are the kinds of problems that institutions regularly protect themselves from in Australia, or like on a societal level, basically anywhere. And this applies whether it's happening in a Muslim or non-Muslim context. I guarantee you that everything that we're talking about right now is totally and completely applicable to a Muslim country, whether you like it or not. I feel like sometimes multiculturalism is a cop-out in terms of how we're supposed to conduct ourselves, because like it's totally transferable. It's totally transferable and marginally more difficult to deal with and address in the Muslim world, unfortunately, because of how the power structures are set up. But at least here, it took the bravery of one woman, yes, but you needed the consensus of so many other women in order to affect that kind of change that we don't know may be successful or not. Like, they've just, the report came out with recommendations. We have no idea as to whether the government's going to really adopt all of them. But the point is, it can't be ignored anymore. It's there and it's glaring at you in the face. And glaring at all of us in the face. And you think you'd like get away with it? No, we started off this year with that problem, and we've just ended the year with that problem, politically speaking. So it now has, like, I guess the, where we are as a society collectively when it comes to dealing with situations like that, is that we are now much more receptive. These aren't issues that are going to be hid under the rug, so to speak, and where we stand as a community with that. I don't think it's Islamically incorrect to say that I am against the mistreatment of Aboriginal people and the injustice that they face, right? Or it's not Islamically incorrect to say that women shouldn't be sexually harassed in the places that they work, no matter what they're wearing or what quote-unquote their behavior is alluding to. I feel like these are very much part and parcel, like, given and very basic and common sense approaches to what is happening. And it's really odd when it comes to, like, say, the Muslim community, or when you bring it into a Muslim context, and there's always this resistance to talk about it, or at least even, like, say, do a story about it. Because I do get that question from time to time, and being like, are you worried that you are exposing, like, your community problems? I'm like, well, what is the alternative then? Like, if you've tried addressing it internally and nothing happens and the problems keep persisting and you bring light to it, but not only that, but within a context of being like, well, if anything, it says that the Muslim community has at least assimilated very well in Australia to see the same issues that are plaguing us are plaguing the rest of society. So yay for us, we're in line. But I just find it really disingenuous to say that it's not worth bringing attention to, because if we're just going to sit here and say the only Muslim stories that are really well and truly authentic to us are the positive ones, because we need to be represented positively all the time. Those are the only kind of stories worth doing, and we're just going to sit there and pretend like none of this is happening. That's disingenuous and that's wrong, in my opinion. That's not being honest. And particularly with my, like, from what I've learnt here, and at least from what I've seen in the US and UK, I think what happens is that, again, there's this, like, worry and paranoia of like Islamophobia being conflated with what's happening, like, in the Middle East or in the sub-Indian continent, or through foreign policy decisions, or what's being said about us in a collective that's led us to this really avoidant spot. I believe you're able to have both nuances exist in the same space, where you're able to tackle Islamophobia, but then also have space to talk about problems within the Muslim community. Because chances are, and it's 100% right, that it's the same issues that are plaguing every other community. It's just manifesting in a Muslim context. I believe there's room for both. And I think that we've arrived at a point where we're able to talk about both. We're not living in an immediate post 9/11 world anymore. You know, like, it's not to that extent. The world has changed so much since 2001. It's been 20 years. And if there's anything that's happened in this discussion with you, I don't think I would be sitting here talking to you about Australia taking action on climate change, or taking Indigenous Australians seriously, or even talking about, like, sexism and actually accepting it as a statement of fact, as instead of, like, a question mark of the evil feminist liberal arm trying to destroy masculinity in Australia. Like, we're in a completely different place now. And if we don't start to move towards that, then when exactly are we going to get to that point, right? Because then what would happen, I think, when it comes to people asking, I want Muslim representation in the media, is that, and I think it's already happening right now, is that you're going to have Muslim journalists avoid doing Muslim stories because they don't want to be associated with that, and they just want to do their job. And their whole goal of Muslim representation shouldn't be based on how positively you reflect your community in your work. It's more about getting to that point where the journalism that we do is not going to be hinged upon the fact that we're Muslim. It's just going to be an afterthought. Right? Like that our journalism is not going to be distinguishable from other people, like, it's going to be that commonplace, you know what I mean? It's like, oh no, that Muslim journalist did it, we need to side-eye it, you know, like, that's the goal. And if you're going to do journalism well, you need to do the good, the bad, and the ugly in almost everything that you do, and you need to do it as honestly and as factually as possible.
So I wanted to touch on quick points in terms of, you know, the stuff that you said. And Mashallah, you said really good stuff, and I have things to add as well. And, you know, your point about, I think sometimes in the Muslim community, there's like that kind of binary of like Islam and not un-Islam. Obviously, like, there's that perspective of, you know, we look through the Islamic lens and all that. But when it comes to different issues, it's like those binaries, like, oh, they're not Muslim, it doesn't matter, etc. But the issues that we face, we can see it play out, as you articulate as well, in other communities. And it's important to highlight that, especially when from the Islamic perspective of justice and, you know, being, you know, just in our actions and being, you know, trying to fulfill the tenets within Islam. And we see even in many instances within the Seerah, for example, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam made, you know, talk specifically about Hilful Fudul and the Fijar Wars, etc. Instances where injustices occurred, and it wasn't necessarily from the perspective of very like Islamic cause per se. It was more like a perspective, for example, there was a man that wasn't pretty much paid for his goods and all that sort of stuff, and the war broke out because the underlying thing was like, you know, bring justice in that context. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam actually, you know, spoke highly about that kind of situation, said that he would partake in it. So, like, anyways, point is like, there is, we can see within our tradition, right, the scope for these kind of discussions. And so when we sort of don't, you know, even highlight the importance of the issues that we're suffering, and that's like playing out in the same way in other communities, it's like we're doing an injustice to ourselves and to Islam in some ways. So it's really important to highlight that. And that's why, like, conversations like feminism and critical race theory, etc., like, get really, and at times very heated, etc. But, you know, obviously, that you can always make the argument that within feminism there's aspects where, you know, it may contradict Islamic principles, etc. But, you know, it's more about using, you know, the conversation should be in terms of when there's women kind of highlighting issues that are happening within the community, it's about taking heed and taking notice, etc. And so, like, it's a very long conversation, but yeah, like, me and Raf talked a lot about it, and it's really important to highlight these specific issues that are happening, not just in our communities, in other communities as well, because, you know, at the end of the day, we want to be just, and, you know, in the
you
way
don't that we need to take it that far. Like, if you're going to talk community-wise, you don't even need to take it to a level like critical race theory or feminism. Like, you can break it down to the main points in saying that, hey, racism is not only wrong, it's also haram, so why is it still happening here? Right? And we're over here being like, well, we spout that we need to prioritize the treatment of women and that their rights are protected in Islam. Okay, well then, can you find out why that's not happening in our own backyard? Like, we don't even need to get academic about it, because I think that's where we lose a lot of our, like, audience community wise from that lens. And if you're thinking about trying to explain it to, like, an elderly population, or trying to even translate it into different languages, you need to have, like, a core messaging and being like, hey, this is happening and it's not cool anymore, and we can't say that we stand for it if we don't, like, actually follow through with what we're saying by actions.
Yeah, definitely. I was more also alluding to the discussions or the hysteria when it comes to these topics being raised, but I think people miss the point of those you know, fields of study as well, and what they seek to achieve, which is, I guess, the broad point we were talking about was issues that, I guess, that us in the Muslim community face. You know, there's other issues as well in other communities, and, you know, those fields of study seek to highlight them, etc. So there's that as well. And the other point as well I wanted to add in is, especially when it comes to, you mentioned an interesting point about representation in the Muslim community. I think even that is a difficult issue. And I think for myself, you know, trying to run this podcast, I also kind of go through it in the perspective that if someone sees you doing like Islamic project or even out there in the community, it could be, you know, like yourself, like a journalist, or it could be a sports player that's Muslim. It's like, since there's like not many Muslims within those spaces already, it's like you become the kind of figurehead in terms of all things to do with Islam in that sense. And so you have that, people may have the high expectation of you to go about being a Muslim in a certain way. And, you know, you have that sort of maybe added pressure. It depends on the person. Like if they see it from that perspective of, look, I want to represent the community in the best manner, then yeah, like I think in the back of your mind that may be an added pressure. And so by in saying that, it's like I think naturally there's a level of scrutiny that will arise from that, in the sense that if you fall short in a little place, or even like there's a whole, we know within our own Muslim community there's like, for example, Sufis versus Salafis and this and that, and so there's already groups within like our community, and so there's different differences of opinion in regards to different issues or all that sort of stuff. So when someone does, like, I don't know, Maliki wears shorts, or I'm being very stereotypical, or like just reducing the convo, like, you know, they're gonna be like, you know, what's wrong with you, etc. If, you know, just the rest of the, I guess, Muslim community see it from the perspective of, I don't know, the Hanafi or Shafi kind of opinion, etc. That's a bit of a weird example, but that's just one example I can think of back of my mind. But yeah, stuff like that, it's like there's already ways where you will be scrutinized even more. And so it's like, I remember watching an interview, like Riz Ahmed and that you know, that funny brother from England, for his name, who does that show as well on Netflix. But anyways, name skipping my mind. Man Like Moby guy. And like they all did this like interview, and they were just talking about that, actually, like the Muslim representation and all that. And then it was really interesting. I think all of them sort of came to this own realization that it's like, it's not even possible, in the sense that you're always going to be like scrutinized. And so it's better to just be you, but obviously, you know, strive to be, you know, Deen Islamic and all that. But in saying that, it's like, don't kind of go into a thinking, you know, you sort of have this representation and, you know, having this kind of idea that you need to represent your community, etc. Because, you know, it probably won't pan out in the way that you think it will. It may even get, you know, I think the scrutiny from our own communities can be very, you know, intense. And so, you know, it'll be a lot to manage. And so it's like, go into it kind of being yourself, representing yourself, your own experiences, etc., and people may relate to that. And that's how I think they were just sort of expressing from that perspective, in that, like, you know, people gravitate towards you rather than kind of you being this flag bearer for your own community. So that was an interesting take as well. And I think, not that I'm any sort of figure, but like, I guess, you know, in terms of running this podcast, like I always try to, you know, be myself as well on social media or whatever, like say whatever I want. Cause I think, you know, sometimes I used to have that very Islamic perspective, like maybe a year or two ago, especially on Twitter, like, you know, very, very religious and, you know, kind of have that wall kind of put up and all that. But I think, you know, the authenticity gets lost as well. Like you want to be authentic, you want to relate. Like I was just like, literally yesterday I was just posting up, like, you know, the Spotify Unwrapped stuff. Like I think there's a level of relatability that needs to be had as well, in the sense of like what the wider community is up to, and kind of being yourself in that sense as well. So there's that as well. And the other thing I wanted to mention, because I pulled up, because even when it comes to like, for example, in the context of racism, right, we're talking about, for example, if I think you're talking about, you know, a female comes out and talks about their experiences and, you know, the struggles they've encountered, you know, there's a whole situation they have to deal with in terms of, you know, court proceedings, all that sort of stuff. And I guess in the context of even like within racism, and especially in the specifically the Azeem Rafiq case, it's like he had to do these you know, press hearings, court hearings, laying everything out. And, you know, that's even more scarring. That's like, even like, you just make a simple point, like, you know, through your lived experiences, like these issues happen, you know, institutionally. And so it's like you having to be in a position where you have to explain yourself. And it's like, in that, naturally in that discourse, it's like, you know, people will, you know, really go after your personality and gaslight you. And so that becomes even more like stressful and difficult to deal with, right? It's like you have to prove yourself to others that you're really, you know, you've really experienced those experiences, which is like pretty, yeah, like mentally scarring, right? And not only this, that the legal fees will probably be also there, and, you know, money spent and all that sort of, you know, exhaustion
is, or like, it takes a toll on your career prospects. You know, like, people don't want to hire or employ you anymore, because they see you as a liability. And then there's the personal toll as well. There are people who, you know, you'd probably never think would turn their back on you, but do. Like, all of this is happening behind the scenes. Who knows how many family members will disown you, how many friends will leave you, that kind of a thing. That's all happening as well.
Yeah, there's so many dynamics to unpack, and it's you know, it's frightening. And I guess in the case of, because I just pulled it up, like, in terms of, like, the stuff that Azeem Rafiq said that he encountered, that he endured during his time within Yorkshire Cricket Club. You know, so me and other people from an Asian background, there were comments such as, "You'll sit over there near the toilets." They called them also elephant washers, the 30-year-old Rafiq said. And off-spinner who had dreamt of playing for England said cricket was blighted by institutional racism up and down the country. And he said he also recounted an experience being pinned down and forced to drink alcohol at the age of 15 when he was at his local cricket club. And there's other stuff, like other players that said other stuff. But like, those are just, like, you know, the little things that I guess he had to encounter. And you can imagine being put in a position to explain himself, essentially, right? And which is sad, right? And it's scarring. And I guess that goes to show how much we have to go through, and I guess how important it is with, you know, public sentiment and, you know, making sure the community are backing each other, especially, like, for example, Adil Rashid coming out, which is really, you know, mashallah, good on him for, like, you know, coming out and kind of supporting and agreeing with, you know, Azeem Rafiq in that case as well. So it's really important that he has a backing community, because he's probably all alone in this as well, right? And so that's also really important to take into consideration. But yeah.
Oh yeah, for sure. Like, there are so many ramifications to even deciding what to do in order to come out with this. Like, they can never fully be realized. Like, another thing as well, I think, to keep in mind, as much as we can talk about it as an issue, it's always going to be personal to them. And not only that, but, like, this decision impacts everyone around them. So it's not just him or Brittany or anyone else being subject to this kind of scrutiny, but, you know, you'll have his family members kind of answering for his actions. You've got, like, you know, the way, if he's got children, it's going to impact that. Like, I know with Brittany's situation, like, it impacted her partner's employment because of who she was and what she did. When you look at it, like, in terms of, like, the Palestine situation with Muhammad Al-Kord and his sister, right? Like, he was very vocal, he was very eloquent and succinct, spoke out very early about what was happening, and then as a result they targeted his home again. Like, it just ramped up. He and his sister got detained as well. There's always going to be a cost, both personal and otherwise, to bring these issues to surface, that I think that the media can't really cover that well, because we don't have access to those personal struggles, of course. But I think as well, there needs to be more room for empathy and space for them to navigate through that. But I'm not sure whether we will get to that place. In terms of Muslim representation as well, I think another really important thing that people need to realize is that you're not going to get to control the kind of representation that you get. When we're going to say that Muslim representation is normalized, it's also going to be normalizing in conjunction with the very traditional practicing Muslim, working in media, you're going to juxtapose that with an atheist Muslim or a purely cultural Muslim or a Muslim whose opinions don't line up with the community consensus in any way, shape, or form. And you don't get a say into what you pick and choose, that's like as to how that's going to look like. And I find it almost laughable that it's like, oh, okay, we're just going to disown this person entirely because of X, Y, Z, or we're just going to gravitate or follow this person because of what they look like and stand for on the outside. There needs to be more room for nuance. And again, I think it just goes back to that lack of complexity that we have. We're still thinking that everything needs to be positive and above board or bust. And if we can't do that with the content or the kind of people that already exist in our community, like it's not like they just came out of the world, it's like it's right there. If we're not going to be comfortable with that at all, then maybe we shouldn't be asking for representation in the first place. Maybe we should all just leave the media space entirely if it's going to be such a problem. And I think it is highlighted particularly in media because it is so visible and it's just the nature of the industry. Are we having the same conversations about visibility and Muslim representation in STEM the same way? Are we having it in the same wavelength as, I don't know, textiles, horticulture, biology, like anything that's not in front of a screen? Are we having that? You know, and that's something that I always try to keep in mind with as well. Is there this hyperfixation because of the medium that it's in?
Definitely. And I know you've touched on it, but I guess in summary, I guess to ask as a last question on the show, like, because it was fascinating, remind me of, is we did a long episode with Abdullah Kunde a while back, and he alluded to when he went through his own sort of experiences when it comes to when he was, had to resign from Labour Party. What essentially happened was the media was pretty hostile in how it portrayed things, more of the bigger name corporations, but then. In saying that, when I asked him, like, I think I forgot the exact question, but it was more so around the subject of like, oh, does that mean like, you know, we can't really truly be represented as Muslims in media? But he alluded to talking to different media organizations. I think, like, for example, the specific Christian media, and they actually allowed him to give him the airtime that he essentially needed in order to explain his perspective. And so the question to you is like, you know, in your sort of experience, would you say like there's actually a proper, space for Muslims, being authentically, represented within our media? Is there like actually a space for us to really be our own and hold it down? Or is it, we'll always be, suffocated in a certain way where we can only do so much and that's it? Or like, do you actually generally see there are ways that, or there's opportunities for us to be represented authentically, but within the media space when it comes to, talking about the Muslim community, and it's like we have to go seek it out because we haven't done the hard yards yet as a community?
I think that is only going to come with its own platform, to be completely honest. If you like, it really depends on what you mean by authentic and all of that. And I think a hard thing to keep in mind, again, and I think it's like this, I keep repeating myself, it's like this dichotomy that we're in. We can't expect that we're going to find a platform that will just exclusively show all Muslim perspectives of our community as authentically as possible existing within the media industry, because that's not what it's set up to do. It's set up to canvas as many perspectives as possible, cover such a wide range of topics that it doesn't even have the bandwidth to dedicate it to one thing. If that's what we're after, it's a space that we need to seek out, especially because I'm pretty sure people will want this on our own terms. And it's not, and like, I don't necessarily agree with it being suffocating, because I think we're conflating, when we're asking about Muslim representation, thinking that if we get enough Muslims in there, then they'll pave the way for us in these existing organizations to have just a dedicated, authentic space. That's not going to happen. You know, like, it needs to be realistic about that. And then the alternative is to create your own platform. And even then, it's like defining that kind of media per se. Like, the format and the space and what that's going to look like is going to be up for discussion, because if you're going to try and emulate what's happening, or like what the media industry looks like, and say, okay, I'm going to copy paste this and make this into like a Muslim institution, a lot of the structures internally are not going to hold up, because a big part of these organizations is to remove any association with that to achieve some kind of impartiality as much as possible, some objectivity. That way you're able to report on everything. And so the very notion of authentic Muslim media belies a specific perspective and a specific narrative. And so when you ask that question, or when people ask that, like, you know, if you think we're going to get enough Muslims in media to create this, A plus B is not going to equal C. Do you get what I'm saying? Like, this is something that you're going to need to create from the ground up. And I know that there have been attempts. It's very fragmented at the moment. I think it can be possible, but it's still a big question mark as to what that's going to look like specifically, especially in Australia.
Definitely. And thank you for those insights. And it's important to keep that all in mind as well, I guess, as a community going forward, inshallah. And I really appreciate your time on the show. I think we touched on very, you know, good, very solid and, you know, diverse set of topics, inshallah, you know, more like, probably have to brand it as like a sports podcast, you know, part-time. But like, I think it was really important that we talked about those issues to the point where it's like activism playing out within sport and how that manifests, and right, you know, talking about those issues in regards to, you know, for example, racism. So I think I really enjoyed the conversation, and, you know, thank you for jumping on the show and giving us your time, Ryma.
No worries, anytime.
So for our listeners, thank you for giving us your attention. If you have any questions or queries, feel free to email us at info@boysinthecave.com. And you can find us on Facebook, and we're on Instagram, Twitter. Send us a DM. You know, you can always post up, you know, our episodes on your Insta stories, and we'll post them up as well, inshallah. And make sure to give us a 5-star ratings, inshallah, as that greatly helps us. And we're on YouTube as well. Make sure to check us out there. And so for our special guests, Ryma and myself, we wish you all the best. This is Tanzim signing off. Assalamu alaikum.